Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our special service today. We're focusing on the work of Novi Mosque International, a Christian organization working in Bosnia and Herzegovina amongst young people. So I'm looking forward to hearing more of that and sharing more of that with you later in the service. But for now, we're going to say hello to those who are helping in deliver this service. So we've got Roy and Steph doing the
Hello.
things, and Mike, who's leading our intercessions.
Hello
Okay, so a moment of quiet, and then we'll begin with our gathering prayers. God is good.
all the time.
All the time.
God is good.
We stand before the throne of God with countless crowds from every nation and race, tribe and language.
Blessing and glory and wisdom, thanksgiving and honor, power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen.
And as we think of our majestic and glorious God, we're going to sing a song now, Beauty for Brokenness, and it's a song about transformation.
Children, cast it.
And as we think of God's goodness, sometimes it makes us think of how we've let him down or let ourselves down in the way we've behaved or the things we've thought. And so for our confession today, I just thought we'd have a time of quiet and let you reflect on the last few days and just consider where there's anything, whether you need to confess something to the Lord in your attitude or in the things you have done in a moment of quiet. And as we come to God in faith, we know that his forgiveness is always there waiting for us. So may the God of love bring us back to himself, forgive us our sins, and assure us of his eternal love in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We're going to watch a video now produced by the Novimos team working in Bosnia and Herzegovina. And some of you will be aware of the work in any case, but this is a good introduction if you haven't heard of the work before or don't really know what it's about. So sit back and relax and enjoy this informative video.
We are Novimos, a UK Christian charity pioneering youth work in Bosnia and Herzegovina. We equip young people to enter their futures with hope and confidence. We empower them to be the change in their local communities. For too long, the words Bosnia and Herzegovina have had a negative connotation for too many people, partly because of the war the country experienced in the early 90s, partly because of the economic, social, and political struggles it has faced in the two decades since. Novimos was born out of a response to the humanitarian crisis caused by war. It continues to exist as a response to the ongoing challenges faced by young people growing up in a country crippled by corruption, ethnic division, and severe unemployment. Bosnia and Herzegovina currently has the highest youth unemployment rate in Europe, so it's not surprising that so many young people grow up thinking their only future is to look for a new life in another country. We have teams of local and international workers based in four towns around the country, working both in independently established youth centres and in partnership with local evangelical churches. Through all the activities we do, we bring young people from different backgrounds together. Informal education, accredited courses, trips, camps and conferences are all developing cultures of possibility and hope. For us, pioneering youth work means being prepared to challenge the norm. It means equipping and empowering local leaders and young people so they can transform their communities. And we need your help. Will you help us make the most of every opportunity for young people in Bosnia and Herzegovina today?
Again, many of you will know that I have a very personal interest in the work of Novimos. Novimos is an organisation that seeks to bring young people of different ethnic groups together and to work in harmony in what is a fragmented and broken country. And I started working for Novimos in 1997. I had a part-time job and just helped to process the donations that were coming in. And after about a year, I was training for ministry at the time, summer camps began. This photo of the two boys shows them at summer camps. And you may or may not be aware, but one is Bosniak and one is Croatian. And you can see the love they have for each other, which is quite special. Anyway, summer camps, and I offered to do the recruitment of summer volunteers to go out to Bosnia for 2 weeks. So teams of volunteers from UK churches to go out to Bosnia to serve actually on the Croatian coast. That's where the camps were. And my role involved training and equipping them before they went, giving them loads of information, making sure that we follow due process as they went, and then following up afterwards. And I don't need to say too much about me, but over the years I got more and more involved and ended up being director, as you'll hear later on. Bosnia is a country, a beautiful country of waterfalls and rivers. This is a place called Kravica, which I've been to many times. It's just a fabulous, beautiful place. It was unspoilt when we first went, but now it's a major tourist attraction. And Bosna actually means water. But it's also a land of mountains. It's a rocky, hard place. This is a picture of Mostar, and you can see all the hills surrounding the city. Of course, you will know by now, or you will remember, that there was a war in Bosnia in 1992 to 95. And if you visit today, you will still see evidence of the war, but there's lots of tourism now. This is on the sides of the Stari Most Bridge in Mostar. A lot of tourism. It's really taken, well, before COVID anyway, there were lots of tourists either going in for the day from Croatia, that was the biggest case, or just going there to have a look around. It's very pretty. Very nice place to be. But it's also a place of progress. And this is a new shopping centre in the middle of Mostar. Well, it was new when the photo was taken, but that was about 4 years ago now. Novi Most, it's a funny name, isn't it? But it means new bridge in local language. So the official language in Bosnia and Herzegovina is actually Serbo Krat, but you don't say that, you say local language, because then it's inclusive and doesn't exclude the Bosniaks. Here is the Stari Most, the bridge, which was devastated during the war and which over the years was rebuilt. And on the 20th anniversary of Mostar, I was still of the 20th anniversary of Novi Most, we had a celebration where all the young people from both sides of the city drummed through. We followed a drumming band, the Sarajevo drumming band, through the city on both sides, and we ended up on the Stari Most Bridge, which is quite a symbol of unity. So Novi Most works to bring hope and confidence to young people that they would bring transformation to their communities. And I'm aware, you know, I've spoken in some places about the work of Novi Most, and some people think that Bosnia might be in Africa. So I'm just going to clarify. And again, you will know this if you know anything. It's in Eastern Europe. Bosnia and Herzegovina is in Eastern Europe, and it's about 1,000 miles from London. So it takes a 2.5 hour flight-ish to Split or Dubrovnik, and then a 3 hour journey by road. You can get flights to Sarajevo or even Mostar, but they're not as frequent or as cheap as the ones to Croatia. And here's a map of Bosnia and Herzegovina. You'll see the mustard coloured map. That's the Serb Republic, Republika Srpska, where the majority of those of Serbian ethnicity live. And then the yellow is where the Bosniaks and Croats live. And the little N with the arrows, those are places that Novi Most works. So we began in Mostar. We then extended to Chaklina, then we worked in Jajce, and then Sarajevo, which is the capital. So we work in four places in the country, independent youth work, but working in partnership with the Evangelical Church. And just for clarity, again, three main ethnic groups, Serbs, who are Serb Orthodox by religion, around about 30%. Remember, they're living in that mustardy coloured area, which the division was set by the Dayton Peace Accords, which brought an end to the war. The Croats, who are generally Roman Catholic, 15%, and then the Bosniaks, the Muslims, who are about 45% of the population. And the work of Novi Most, It depends in what city we are working as to what ethnic group we are most likely to be working with. But because we're in different cities, we can have days out and trips out and bring the young people together. So that's just a little snapshot, just some information to set everything into context. But before we go any further now, we're going to listen to Roy as he brings our gospel reading from Luke to us.
A reading from Luke chapter 14, verses 7 to 14. When he noticed how the guests picked the places of honour at the table, he told them this parable. When someone invites you to a wedding feast, do not take the place of honour, for a person more distinguished than you may have been invited. If so, the host who invited both of you will come to you and say, "Give this person your seat." Then, humiliated, you will have to take the least important place. But when you are invited, take the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he will say to you, "Friend, move up to a better place." Then you will be honoured in the presence of all the other guests. For all those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. Then Jesus said to his host, "When you give a luncheon or dinner, do not invite your friends, your brothers or sisters, your relatives, or your rich neighbours. If you do, they may invite you back and you will be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed. Although they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous." This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, Roy. That reading is particularly relevant because at an early stage in Novimos history, it was one of those core scriptures that helped us formulate what we were about as an organisation. And I just want to read verse 13 again. "But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed. Although they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous." And it was sort of speaking into a situation where in a fragmented country that's been divided by war, people sort of flock to their own. So that's what happened. As the war began, people went to their own places of religious security, if you like. So the synagogues and the churches were full to overflowing, where they hadn't necessarily been so beforehand. And what that meant was that folks weren't integrating. And this scripture, "invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind," wasn't necessarily about people with those physical disabilities, but it was saying go out and invite any and everyone. Everyone is worthy of hearing and knowing the gospel of Jesus Christ and the love of God. That was the thing, that in a country that had been devastated by hatred, we just wanted to bring God's love to everybody, whoever they were. And so this scripture is particularly meaningful. And it's been a part of, I suppose, my spiritual formation as well, that we don't set up ourselves boundaries against people. We don't only associate with people who are the same as us. So you'll see in verse 12, "Then Jesus said to his host, 'When you give a lunch or dinner, do not invite your friends, your brothers or sisters or relatives or your rich neighbours. If you do, they may invite you back and so you'll be repaid.'" So that's just like being social and having a good time together, which is not a bad thing to do at all. But when you give a banquet, so he's talking to his disciples, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind. And at that time, for us in our ministry, this was a key scripture. So I share it with you today. So you can think about that yourself. And of course, you know, in these COVID days, there's lots of connotations about security, and but there's also a lot of need. And as the people of God here in this place, we need to be thinking about those who cannot repay us, that we give without asking for anything back. So just a little chat about that reading. We're going to move on now, and I'm going to ask you to do some imagining yourself. And I've got two questions for you to consider. And I hope you don't draw a blank on either of them. The first question is, if you could imagine anything for Bosnia and Herzegovina today, what would it be? If you could imagine anything for Bosnia and Herzegovina, what would it be? Just a moment to think about that. You might want to jot down your answers. If you're watching with other people, you might like to discuss that. Just pause the video if you're not watching us live. Or you can write your answer in the chat, the feedback on the Facebook page. For a moment, just to think about that, to think about what your dreams might be for Bosnia and Herzegovina. And then a second question, which might be a little bit easier, I don't know. If you could imagine anything for St. Catherine's Church, what would it be? If you could imagine anything for St. Catherine's Church, what would it be? And the same thing, you could write down your answer or put some feedback in the comments section, or talk with whoever you're watching this with. And please just feel free to email me at raoljill@gmail.com if, having thought of these things, you've got something you feel you would really like to share. So, having imagined those things, we're now going to listen to another reading, which Steph is bringing us from Ephesians 3.
A reading from Ephesians chapter 3, starting at verse 16. I pray that out of his glorious riches, he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all the Lord's holy people, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus through all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
So to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we can ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. God has got far more for us than we can ask for or imagine. Whatever plans we have, God's plans are always bigger and better. Isn't that amazing? Have any of you been watching The Sewing Bee on BBC One? The sewers have three tasks or challenges to do in each programme, and they're all on a theme. The first is to make something using a pattern. The second is to make an item of clothing out of other things without any pattern at all, just using their creativity. Things like t-shirts or uniforms or parachute material. And the third challenge is to make a fantastic garment of their own design, each within a given time period. Now, I'm not a particularly good sewer, although my mother was, but I really enjoy watching the programme to see what they're going to produce, what they produce out of nothing or other things, out of flat material or other clothes, and out of their own imaginations. It's wonderful to see what they do. It's more than I could imagine. Now, I'm not really suggesting that the sewers are like God and we are like the material, because that somehow doesn't quite capture the magnitude of what God does through his people. And yet there is a sort of parallel in the stories of our own lives as we let God work in them, creating wonderful human beings out of the raw material we were when we were born. That our lives evolve into something more than we could ever ask or imagine through God's power working in us. Not for our own sakes as such, but for the glory of his church and for Jesus Christ. That isn't to say things are always easy. They certainly aren't. But the big picture is that as we say yes to God, he uses our yeses to achieve wonderful things for him. The work of Novimos began through the yes of a Croatian lorry driver, Nikola Skrinjaric, who, as war was breaking out in Bosnia and Herzegovina, took a truckload of stoves from Zagreb in Croatia to Mostar in Bosnia. He saw pockets of war breaking out as he drove down through the country, arriving at Mostar in the Christmas of 1992. And he responded to God's call to stay there as everyone else was leaving the city, to stay there, bringing people together from different ethnic groups as the war was breaking out, to read the Bible and to worship God. And Novimos was born through the initiative of leaders of Spring Harvest in 1993, when Nicola and I think they were only engaged then, but his fiancée Sandra were keynote speakers. Now, amazingly, I was there as a volunteer at Spring Harvest on the children's team. And when Nicola and Sandra got a standing ovation in the big top after sharing their story, I stayed sitting, not because I didn't admire what they were doing, but because I really didn't feel I understood what was going on and why I'd be clapping. I felt like I just didn't want to go along with the flow. I was introduced to Nicola, however, as I met him in the Spring Harvest Resources Hall, as Paul, who was a neighbour of mine at the time, was hosting him. Little did I know then that, one, God would use Nicola's yes to achieve the re-establishment of the Bosnian Evangelical Church, two, that God would use Nicola's yes to create a Christian organisation solely committed to children and young people in Bosnia and Herzegovina, and three, that less than 10 years later, I would not only be ordained in the Church of England, but that I would have become full-time director of Novimos. And today, here I am as your vicar, sharing with you what God has done through the work of Novimos, bringing the mission of God in Bosnia and Herzegovina to our doorsteps here in Tilehurst. Who knows what will happen in the future? And I only share this to heighten your awareness of what God can do through you when you say yes to him. God has done immeasurably more than all I could ask or imagine. His agenda is so much bigger than my own. I mean, when I started getting involved with Novimost, it was simply to process the gifts and work in the office. That's all I thought I was ever going to do. So your story will be a different one, but I look around me now and I see many lives at St. Catherine's that have been dramatically transformed because of that same power working in you, the power of the living God working in and through you, doing more than we could ever have asked or imagined. I can't share everything because it would embarrass you. Lockdown has been difficult, but it has been great to see the cafe now offering hope to people who without it would be lonely and isolated. The Friday deliveries are bringing hope to those who can't leave their homes. I see our green team seeking to bring hope to all of us today, but especially the younger generation, as they seek to galvanise us all into further action to care for our planet and combat climate change. And there's lots more I could imagine, things like renewed energy and interest in Bible study and in prayer. If you have difficulty wondering what God has done through you, all you have to do is ask yourself what your life would be like had you not become a believer. How would you be spending your time? Who would you have met today and what conversations would you have had? What difference has having Jesus in your life made to you? We can only see the present and the past. But in a few years' time, as we reflect and look back, we will see once again that God has done more than all we could have asked or imagined, re-energizing us with his spirit as we say yes to Jesus, empowering us to bear witness to him through the good times and the bad. Because of the work of Novimost in Bosnia and Herzegovina, the lives of scores of young people are being transformed today. God is working his redemptive powers out through the yeses of the Novimost workers and the yeses of the young people as they take up the opportunities being offered to them, and through your yeses as you pray for Novimost and give financially too, offering the hope of the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ to young people who currently have no idea how much God loves them, or the hope to which he calls them. Once received, the hope that Jesus gives is a hope which cannot be taken away. It's a hope which will last for all eternity, strengthening and empowering fragile lives with joy in living today, knowing that God will do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine through his power working through us. As we say yes, yes to Jesus. We're going to sing about that hope now in the words of Cornerstone.
Through the storm, he is the Lord.
Joined together, let us pray for the church, for the world, and for ourselves. And we pray for all those who minister to the sick, nurses, doctors, and all NHS staff, to all carers, whether in residential care homes, or those who minister to the sick at home. Give them patience, understanding, compassion, and caring hands as they daily seek to improve the well-being of all in their care. Lord, hear us. Lord, hear our prayer. In our prayers, we bring to you all those who we know who are in pain, whether physically or mentally, for those who are waiting the results of tests, and for those who have received results that are not what they wanted, and for those who are waiting for operations, and the delay is causing them pain and suffering. And so in a minute's silence, we lift them to you. We ask for your healing and your peace. Give them peaceful days and peaceful nights. Lord, hear us. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray especially for all those who are in troubled relationships, for those who are afraid they may say the wrong word or do the wrong thing, for fear of either being verbally abused or physically beaten, or both. Release them from the pain that their life holds, and we pray that they may find a life of happiness and love. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, hear us. Loving God, in a world of harmony and brokenness, peace and conflict, protect our children and our young people from images that harm them, from words that wound, and people that abuse them. Bless, guide and protect them through their young days. Lord, hear us. Lord, hear our prayer. And this time we remember all those groups worldwide who seek to bring peace and healing to those who have only experienced war and hatred in their early lives. And we remember especially at this time the Novimus groups who bring together youngsters from different backgrounds and equip them for their lives ahead. Because today's youngsters are tomorrow's leaders. Pour out your blessings upon them. Unite and connect with them, and that they may go from strength to strength. Lord, hear us. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for the Christian Aid Community Action Group in the Reading area and for the work that they do, and especially for the work of the van crews as they continue to work collecting and delivering donations around the Reading area during the pandemic. And we pray that you will keep them safe. And Lord, we pray also for those who generously donate furniture so that others may benefit from their generosity. Lord, hear us. Lord, mercifully hear us. Father, we continue to offer prayer for Alak Sharma, our local MP and president of the CP26 conference that will meet in Glasgow in November. And we thank you for his dedication and his work that he is putting in. He's travelling around the world, meeting various leaders. Lord, hear us. Lord, most mercifully, hear us. Father, you know us inside and out. You know our weaknesses and our strengths, our pains and our distress, our fears and concerns as we go through life. Heavenly Father, we lean upon you and we call upon you in our every need, for in life's daily turmoil. Guide us in all we say or do. Be our shepherd and our counsellor as we walk daily through life's twisting and even path. For without you, we are nothing. Lord, hear us. Mercifully hear us. Bless and guide your church here on earth, and especially your church here at St. Catherine's. And we pray that you will continue to make your presence known in our worship, our prayers, and our hymns of praise. And as we reach out into the community, seeking to witness in your name, inspire Jill and Phil in all they do. And may this church be a beacon of light, hope, and a source of salvation to all. Lord, hear us, mercifully hear us. And we remember and pray for all of those whose lives are coming to an earthly close. May their passing be peaceful, and that you, dear Lord, will be there to welcome them into your heavenly kingdom. And we remember all those who have known and loved, and whose anniversary falls at this time. Lord, hear us, mercifully hear us. So now let us say the words of that great prayer that unites all Christians worldwide. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you, Mike. So unusually today, we've got some homework for you. And the homework is to take what you've imagined for Bosnia and Herzegovina, what you've managed to imagine for St. Catherine's, and take those as little prayer seeds to pray into the things you thought, the things that occurred to you, and pray about them. And then let's wait and see what God's going to do. And it may take weeks, months, years, decades. We don't know, but we live in the hope of the glory of God, of what he will do through us, his church here on earth. We're going to sing again now a beautiful hymn, I, the Lord of Sea and Sky. And as you sing this, I pray that you'll be open to whatever God is saying to you today.
I'm not afraid.
Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we can ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. So just a few notices as we come to the end of our time together. And the first really is to ask you to pray for a couple of meetings tomorrow, where the musicians are meeting together in the morning at 11 o'clock to discuss how we will operate in the future as we work out who will do what at our 10 o'clock services as the services merge together. And then we've got a leaders and preachers meeting on Monday evening, where we will also be looking at all the practicalities of what that decision has meant. Sorry, that's my dog, Alfie, barking at someone walking by. Other things, we will have a Bible study on Wednesday night. So last week we did a one-off study on witness. Phil will be emailing those who attended that. But also just to let you know, open invitation, if you'd like to do a one-off study, please get in touch with him. That's curatephil@outlook.com. And cafe will be open as usual on Thursdays and Fridays between 10 and 2. Seated exercises are continuing on Fridays at 11:30, I think. And they're free, so do encourage others to come along. There's a form to fill in for that. And morning prayer will continue this week on Mondays, Wednesdays and Thursdays. Now, we will all be waiting to see what the government will say on Monday about what will happen as to lockdown on the 21st of June. And depending on what that says, morning prayer will continue or we will finish. So more will come out of that decision. So please pray for those in government who are making these decisions that affect us all, really, for wisdom and discernment for them. I think that's all the notices for now. Oh, and don't forget communion at 9 o'clock on Wednesday if you would like to come and join us. That's a quiet traditional said service. Be lovely to see you there. So we'll finish now by saying the grace. And as we say these words, let's remind ourselves that we are part of the Church of God. It's an international community, intergenerational, and Jesus binds us all together. So may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forever. Amen. So now we come to our chit chat. And what I'd like us to think about is where we've seen God do more than all we could ask or imagine in the world or in the church. So over to you, Roy, and then Steph.
Yes, I think one of the nice things that's happened, although the pandemic's been really bad, is that people have been stepping forward to do things, be it organising this online worship, but also in the wider world, people have been volunteering to help elderly people who are housebound to get their groceries in. And then we've seen a massive influx of people volunteering to help the vaccine rollout across the country. Without all these volunteers, it wouldn't be able to happen. So I think
it's truly amazing that, hasn't it? Okay, and Steph?
I think we have in the past seen sort of miracles. Something that just sprang to mind, and it was years ago, I know, but when the miners were trapped, I forget where it was, in one of the South American countries.
Yes.
And, you know, the great effort, and they were all brought back up.
Yeah.
Up alive. And, you know, things like that, that's happened before. I think there were some children, a football team, they were also caught underground. And just recently, the twins, the one that got attacked by a crocodile and, you know, so bravely, her sister jumped in and was able to, well, we don't know whether she is going to survive, but, you know, got her out of the thing. And I think God is there in these situations.
Yeah. Yes, they're just amazing stories, aren't they? Mike?
I think it's through the pandemic, I've seen so many different sides to different people, people I've known for many, many years, and I've seen a much deeper, caring person than I ever thought existed. So from that, I think it's been wonderful. When you've known somebody, 40, nearly 50 years, as I have with most people at St. Catherine's, there's one or two have absolutely shocked me, surprised me in a good way. Never knew possible. Wonderful.
Fantastic. So I've shared in the talk, but one thing I was reminded of just now was how the rise of the digital church online, like with technology, without it, we would have been scuppered, wouldn't we? But because we have technology, the church has been able not just to survive, but to thrive. And actually, if you look over the course of history in God's agenda, you know, the Codex, the Bible coming out in book form, that happened before it was all in scrolls. And just as Jesus came upon this earth, the book form also came. And then if you think of the Reformation and the printing press, you know, and this vast means of communication. And now, through the suffering of the pandemic, it's sort of enabled access to the gospel through the internet, which in a profound way, in a way that has forced, you know, every church in the land really to go online. So that is miraculous and amazing and more than all we could have imagined. So I hope those thoughts encourage you. Maybe you'd like to consider the ways that you've seen God do more than we could ask and imagine in the world or in the church. Anyway, we'll say goodbye for now, and do join the Zoom coffee after church, and we'll see you anon. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.